Yo sé que es un trabajo muy difícil, le diría que le eche ganas, hay días malos y buenos, pero al final todo estará bien. Mi consejo sería decirle que esto no será fácil y va a sufrir al comienzo, pero no por siempre. Se van a desvelar, pero échenle ganas porque todo se puede. Was my mother's response after I informally interviewed her and my father over the phone and asked them to share with me what they would tell a first-generation Latinx college student like my brother and I. I asked him to think back to 8 or 9 years ago when my brother and I left our hometown in Woodburn to follow our family's dream of pursuing higher education. I sat with that piece of advice from my mother and was fascinated to analyze her words. The word sufrir, suffering, caught my attention. My parents had never attended college. They never even had the opportunity to step on a college campus, but they understood that going to college as a first generation Latinx student requires some type of suffering. Que íbamos a sufrir. In sharing my story, I hope it serves as a model for the future of extension in working with students, elevating voices, and diversifying our workforce by empowering marginalized and non-traditional students. During my time at OSU, my goal was to survive and push through obstacles that I faced as low income and first generation. Imagine moving to a new town, not knowing anyone around you, getting weird looks, being questioned, and not knowing where to find help, and just having the funds to make it by. You're alone and you know you are alone. That's what the beginning of my undergraduate years at OSU felt like. There is always a deficit mindset being in a predominantly white campus that was unavoidable. This was the suffering that my parents were talking about. The feeling of not belonging. The parts of us that we will have to give up along the way. Making sense of my new reality was not easy. I was lucky enough that during my time in college, I had the opportunity to meet and work with few individuals who understood my experience. When I came across these individuals, it was like a sense of relief and pride. They got it. These individuals transformed my time at OSU. Just a handful of people who saw me as worthy and who were rooting for me. I often wondered, what if I would have met them sooner? I needed them in high school. My family needed to feel the support too. How would have my journey been different? When I joined the OSU Open Campus Juntos program as a student outreach assistant in 2015, I was just beginning my college journey. I was fortunate enough to become part of a team that was not scared to bring me to the important meetings and meet the important folks. A team that asked for my input and valued my ideas. They truly believed that my life experiences were valuable. I love coming to work. I love having meaningful conversations with the staff. Because of this, I became more involved at OSU. My confidence sparked. I was more willing to take initiatives on projects. I became less afraid to share who I was. And along the way, I found my passion for supporting students in higher education. Towards the end of my undergraduate, I was told by my supervisor that I needed to continue. You need to go to graduate school, they said. They believed in me so much that they worked strategically to open a graduate teaching assistant position to help fund the cost of my graduate program. This last June, I joined Extension as a new Open Campus Juntos program coordinator to serve Marion and Polk counties and their mission to meet the needs of our communities in college and career readiness, degree completion, and economic and community development. Latinos in the United States are the largest growing racial ethnic minority. In Oregon, we account for 13% of the population. Oregon's educational system reflects these trends as 24% of students in kindergarten through grade 12 are Latinx. There are more of us, and even though Latino enrollment is growing, the achievement gaps persist. Latinx students still continue to have the worst graduation rates compared to other students. We continue to have the lowest numbers in college enrollment, college retention, and degree completion. Only 12% of Latino adults have a four-year degree or higher, compared to nearly one-third of white adults. I become part of that 12%, and by luck. Dr. Tara J. Yoso's cultural wealth model examines 6 forms of cultural capital that students of color experience from an appreciative standpoint. Yoso's framework emerges from a shift in viewing communities of color as disadvantaged and instead as communities who have capital that is different from the one we have traditionally learned about in the U.S. context. She also shares that oftentimes the community cultural wealth of students of color is specifically overlooked in the education system. And it reinforces that when the cultural wealth from communities of color is acknowledged, we find that they hold rich cultural capital that can positively contribute to the education system. What if these expectations came from community members, school staff, and mentors? The lives we would touch, the dreams that would come true. Our community needs us, leaders who care, who see our worth. We must continue to acknowledge the breadth and depth of experiences that communities of color bring to spaces like OSU and across Oregon. And we must continue to learn from their life journeys to meet them where they are and create programming that enhances their capital and community cultural wealth, while also challenging policies and practices that perpetuate inequalities and get in the way of celebrating diversity. I wish that through this talk, I can give you the solution to increase high school graduation rates, college enrollment, retention, and graduation among Latinx students, but I'm still trying to figure that out myself. But I can tell you that it takes a village. It takes the work of OSU Extension to continue to provide empowerment and knowledge to our communities across Oregon. If we are not doing the work, who will? This is the work that Extension Service as a contemporary land-grant university should be doing. We need to meet the needs of our communities. And we need to continue to empower youth to find meaningful careers in which they can return to their communities, give back, volunteer, and be the next leaders. We must continue the work to increase access to higher education by prioritizing equity-based work that supports culturally relevant programming. I encourage you to reflect on your own programming and ways that you can collaborate and support other programs in Extension and in your community to fill in the gaps. I encourage you to think whose life will you be touching next and whose dreams you will make come true. I promise you that we have great leaders in the making, and Extension has great mentors. How are we reaching our youth, and how are we moving away from the catching up mindset and embracing the life experiences our communities come with to guide our work?